Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Continuing with the book Umdat al-Fiqh, the chapter of Salah of Imam Ibn Qudamah al-Maqdisi rahimahullah ta'ala. If you could just close your books for a few moments. Last week we spoke about the arkan of the Salah, the rukn, the pillars of the prayer. And we said that the pillars in the prayer are those which are parts of the prayer. And if they are left out intentionally or unintentionally, then that will render the prayer to be invalid. Okay? So there were 12 pillars. Remind me what those 12 pillars are, please. The first of them, what do you think the first of them would be? Think about yourself now doing the actions of the prayer and the most important actions of the prayer. So what would the first of them be? Okay, even before Takbirat al-Ihram, what do you need to do as an action? No, that's a shart, right? Wudu is condition. Not niyyah, niyyah is condition. As an action, what is the action you do before Takbirat al-Ihram? Very good, Jazakallah khair. Qiyam al-Qudra, standing with ability. Then like the brother said, Takbirat al-Ihram. After Takbirat al-Ihram, what? Qiraat al-Fatiha, is that what you're saying? A bit louder, right? Qiraat al-Fatiha. After that, that's not a pillar. That's sunnah. Ruku, okay? Wa raf min al-ruku. Ruku and the raising from the ruku. Then after that, sujood, okay? And the sitting for the sujood, meaning between the al-jalsa anhu, meaning between the two sajdatain, sitting for the sujood. And also you must have tuma'nina, tranquility, right? We said. After the tuma'nina, you must have tashahud. Which tashahud? Huh? Al-akhir. Tashahud al-akhir. And there must be jalus for the tashahud al-akhir. Sitting for the tashahud al-akhir. Okay? And there must be which taslim? The first one, taslimat al-ula. And there must be the last thing? Tartib, very good. These must be in order, okay? So these were the conditions that we took, and you need to memorize these conditions because what we're going to lead to now after the wajibat is the bab sajdatay sahu, how to make the prostration of forgetfulness. And if you don't know what is a rukn and what is a wajib, you won't know when, for what reason you should be making the prostration of forgetfulness. So now we're going to take the wajibat. The wajibat, the Imam, may Allah have mercy upon him, he said that they are seven. Okay? He said the first of them is a takbir. And what he means here by takbir, he means takbir al-intiqal. Okay? Takbir ghayr takbirat al-ihram. The takbir which is done after the takbirat al-ihram. Any takbir for moving. Okay? This is wajib. Okay? The second of them is to make tasbih. What's tasbih? In the prayer, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, where? In the sujood, and Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, in the ruku. Okay, this is also a wajib that you do one at least as a bare minimum. Okay, in the ruku, and then in the sujood. After this, the Imam he mentions, you say, Sami Allahu liman hamida. Okay, when you are getting up from the ruku. You say, Sami Allahu liman hamida, when you are getting up from the ruku. And we said that this is for the Imam. And this is for the one who's praying alone. But for the ma'moom, he says, Rabbana walakil hamd. Yeah? And you must also say the fourth wajib, the fourth obligatory act is that you must say, Rabbi ghfirli bayna sajdatayn. You must say, Allah forgive me between the two sajdas. The fifth of them is the tashahud al-awwal. The first tashahud. Okay? Saying the tashahud. At-tahiyatu lillah. This is what they mean. And the sixth of these obligatory acts is sitting for that tashahud. Okay, you must sit for it. And the seventh and the last of them, the obligatory acts, is that you must send salah upon the Prophet ﷺ in the tashahud al-akhir, in the last tashahud. So these quickly, bil-ujala, quickly are the seven obligatory acts. And we mentioned the 12 arkan. So the Imam says, فَهَادِهِ إِن تَرَكَهَا عَمْدًا بَطَلَتْ صَلَاتُهُ. So these things, if they are left intentionally, then it will render the prayer invalid. وَإِن تَرَكَهَا سَهْوًا سَجَدَ لَهَا. But if the person leaves any of these obligatory acts out of forgetfulness, then he can correct them by making sajda to sahwi, by making the prostration of forgetfulness, okay? Unlike the arkan. The arkan, you have to do it no matter what. The prostration of forgetfulness cannot take the place of the rukn, of the pillar. But it can take the place of the obligatory action if it is left out unintentionally, out of forgetfulness, okay? And then the Imam, he says, وَمَا عَادَ هَذَا فَصُنُّ. And what is apart from these things that we've mentioned, the pillars and the obligatory acts, then everything else is sunnah. لَا تَبْطُلُ الصَّلَاةَ بِتَرْكِهَا. That if you leave it intentionally or unintentionally, it doesn't make your salah invalid. وَلَا يَجِبُ السُّجُودُ لِسَهْوِهَا. And you don't have to make the sujood for forgetting to do it in your prayer. Meaning that if you leave... Is that something for us? That if you leave a sunnah action, okay, then you don't have to make it up by doing the sujood as-sahw. So the Imam, he says now in the chapter which is in front of us, Bab sajdatay as-sahw. The chapter talking about the two prostrations of forgetfulness. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in the hadith in Muslim, إِذَا زَادَ رَجُلْ فِي صَلَاتِهِ أَوْ نَقَصَ فَلْيَسْجُدْ سَجْدَتَيْنِ. That if a person, he increases in his prayer, or he decreases in his prayer, then he should make the prostration of forgetfulness. So for any increase, or for any forgotten thing, for any decrease, that is when you make the prostration of forgetfulness. And the ulama, they give a dhabit for this. A dhabit means like a qualifying rule, a rule which kind of dictates to you when something should be done, okay? That's the meaning of dhabit when they use it in fiqh. The dhabit here is, مَا يَبْطَلُ صَلَاتُهُ عَمْدًا يَسْجُدُ لِسَهْوِهِ. مَا يَبْطَلُ صَلَاتُهُ عَمْدًا يَسْجُدُ لِسَهْوِهِ. That which if you were to do it intentionally, it would lead to the breaking of the prayer, then if it's done unintentionally, then you must prostrate for it. Again, that which if you do it intentionally, it will lead to the breaking of the prayer, then if you do it unintentionally, then you must prostrate for that. Okay, and we will come to know what that means step by step, inshallah. So the Imam, may Allah have mercy upon him, he says, وَسَهْوُ عَلَى ثَلَاثَةِ أَضْرُبُ. This forgetfulness, or our chapter about the prostration, is in three different categories. There are three different areas which concern us in this chapter. He says, أحدها زيادة فعل من جنسها كركعة أو ركن فتبطل الصلاة بعمده. He says, for example, that if you do an increase in a rak'ah, or you do an increase in a rukn, so whoever does that intentionally, then that will break his prayer. If you increase a rak'ah, obviously that will break your prayer. If you increase a rukn, that will break your prayer. It will invalidate your prayer. وَيَسْجُدُ لِسَهْوِهِ. But you can make sujudu sahwu if you did it unintentionally, okay? And this is, of course, the point that we are going to be dealing with. So the Imam, he says, وَإِن ذَكَرَ وَهُوَ فِي رَكَعْتِ زَائِدًا جَلَسَ فِي الْحَالِ. If the person gets up and he prays an extra rak'ah, and he remembers when he's in that rak'ah, the extra unit of prayer, say for example he's prayed Maghrib 3, right? But he got up and he did a fourth one. Or he prayed Dhuhr, which is 4. He got up and he did a fifth one. If he remembers, whilst he's in that extra prayer, what should he do? The Imam says, he has to sit down straight away. Why does he have to sit down straight away? It's not what the Prophet ﷺ taught us, right? And our mother Aisha radiallahu anhu, as in the hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, said that the Prophet ﷺ said, Man amila amalan laysa alayhi amruna fahuwa rad. Whoever does an action which is not from our way, then it will be rejected. Meaning you do something which is not taught to you by the Prophet ﷺ, it will be rejected. And of course the Prophet didn't teach you ﷺ to pray 5 in the prayers which are 4, or to pray 4 in the prayers which are 3. Tayyib, this person who's remembered now in the extra unit, in the extra rak'ah, how does he sit down? Does he make the takbiratul intiqal? Because you know when you're standing to go to sitting, you have to say Allahu Akbar. Should he say Allahu Akbar? No, why not? Because his whole position is an extra, it's invalid. Okay? And if he was to say takbirat al-intiqal, it would make another extra in the prayer, which will also be invalid. Tayyib. The masbuq. Masbuq is a person who misses with the imam a rak'ah or more than a rak'ah. Masbuq. The masbuq is the person who misses with the imam a rak'ah or more than a rak'ah. If the masbuq comes to the prayer and the imam is in his fifth rak'ah, right? But the imam didn't know, he'll realize later on and he'll make the sujood sahwu. So the masbuq has come into the prayer now with the imam who's in his fifth rak'ah. And for the masbuq, it's going to be his first one, right? This extra rak'ah. Because he caught the imam in the fifth extra rak'ah. Can this rak'ah be counted as the first one for this masbuq, the one who came in late? The brother said yes. The majority of the ulama, they say no. Because this is an invalid rak'ah. But our author Ibn Qudamah rahimahullah ta'ala, in his other books, he said yes. So there is that opinion that it's yes. And some, they say no. Tayyib. So the imam, he says after this, وَإِنْ سَلَمَ النَّقْسٍ فِي صَلَاتِهِ أَتَى بِمَا بَقِيَ عَلَيْهِ مِنْهَا ثُمَّ سَجَدَ. If the person who is praying makes taslim for a naqs, for a shortcoming in his prayer. Naqs here, he means the rukn. If he forgot to do a rukn, he's not talking about the wajib. If a person makes taslim and he has a shortcoming in his prayer, like he forgot a rukn, a pillar, then what should he do? He must come with it and then he must make the sujood sahw. Okay, so he has to make that pillar up. The pillar that he forgot, the rukn, okay, he has to make it up. Here, if you look at the wording in Arabic, just before we said that the imam, he said that the first adrub, the first category is ziyada, is an increase. But now he's speaking here about naqs. Why did the imam put naqs, deficiency, with increase? It doesn't make sense. You're talking about increase, and now you've mentioned deficiency. Right, the imam just said that if the person finishes his prayer but he has a deficiency in it, which is that he left out a rukn, then he must make that up. The ulama say the reason he put this here is because the end, the net result of his actions after he comes back with that rukn and he makes the two prostrations and he makes the taslim again, it's going to be an increase, though it's a valid increase. That's why it's put with ziyadah here. Tayyib. So the imam, he says to us, you have to make up the rukn that you have missed out. What if the person remembers like 30 minutes after the prayer? What does he do then in that case? In that case, he, like the brother is saying, he doesn't make it up. Okay, in that case, he has to repeat the prayer altogether. He has to talk the prayer again from you. Because the time lapse was too long. Urfan. Urfan meaning customarily. Okay. So customarily, people would say to him, like, time lapse was too long. You left the masjid, you went and had KFC, and then you remembered, okay? That's too much time, okay? Had it been whilst he was in the masjid, or he got to his car, then he remembered, just like 5 minutes, 10 minutes, then he could have gone back to the salat and just completed what he missed out. But in this case, it was too long, so he had to repeat the salat. What if this person, who needs to make up the rukn we are talking about, right? He remembered after the salat, only after 5 minutes. But he broke his wudu. What does he do then? Here again, he has to repeat the prayer. Though it's only 5 minutes, but he's broken his wudu now. Because he's considered still in the prayer, because he had to complete the prayer. But because he's broke his wudu, like you would in any normal prayer, if you broke your wudu, you would come out of that prayer and you would repeat the prayer altogether. Tayyib, the imam, he says, وَلَوْ فَعْلَ مَا لَيْسَ مِنْ جِنْسِ صَلَىٰ لَسْتَ وَعَمْدُهُ وَسَهْوُهُ. If this person who is praying does something that is not from the actions of the prayer, it doesn't matter whether he did that intentionally or unintentionally. So unintentionally or intentionally doesn't impact upon this issue that we're going to speak about now. So if you do something which is not from the prayer, it doesn't matter whether you did it intentionally or unintentionally. Give me an example of doing something which is not from the prayer. If he answers his phone, talking, eating, right? Things like this, yeah? So the imam, he says, فَإِنْ كَانَ كَثِيرًا أَبْطَلَهَا. If it's a lot, this action, it will break the prayer. What is a lot? We've mentioned this before.
Something that is, if somebody's looking at you, it doesn't appear that you're in prayer.
Beautiful. This is what some of the ulama, they say. They say the determination of what is a lot is that if somebody was looking at you, they would think that you're not in the prayer. You're doing something else. aerobics or something, whatever you're doing, but it's not salah, okay? So this is a determining factor of a lot. Another dhabit, another qualifying rule to determine what is a lot, is mentioned like this. The ulama, they say, أن تكون حركة كثيرة عرفا. أن تكون حركة, the movement, كثيرة is a lot, عرفا, customarily, okay? متوالية, that it's continual. Not that you did one movement or five, two movements in one rakah, then two movements in the next rakah, and throughout the salah you did two in each every unit. This wouldn't be considered a lot because it's not mutawali. Mutawali means it's one after the other. So you did like three movements or four movements in one unit of prayer, not separated, okay? Min ghayri jinsi salah. And it's not from the actions of the prayer, min ghayri darura. So again, أن تكون حركة, that the movement, كثيرة, عرفا, customarily. Okay, it's understood in the custom of your locality that this is a lot of action, okay? متوالية, continually the action is done, not broken up. من غير جنس الصلاة, and it's not from the actions of the prayer, من غير ضرورة, and it's not done based upon ضرورة, based upon need. So when I said من غير ضرورة, what does this take out for us? What this takes out for us is, for example, let's say somebody's praying in his izar or lungi, and the lungi starts to fall down, and he's having to dance around trying to tie it up, and it's like five, six actions. That now is for the maslaha of the prayer. That now is for the benefit of the prayer. So as Muhammad Mukhtar al-Shinqiti mentioned, Hafidhullah, in his explanation, this is something which is valid. You can do as many actions it takes because you need to cover your awrah in the prayer, right? What is, say for example, you're praying and for whatever reason the person in front of you leaves the salah. So now you've got a gap in the rakah, in the saf, sorry. What do you do in this situation? Do you just look at the gap and think how nice a gap it is, or what do? You take steps to fill that gap, right? You move in to fill it. So that could be two or three steps, depending upon how the rows are lined up. So this again is for the maslaha of the salah. It's for the purpose and the benefit of the salah. What about if you saw something which was harmful and you're praying? It's coming near you, it's coming near one of your children as you are praying. You're allowed to do some actions to kill that thing, a little scorpion or something. You can do actions to kill that thing and you're still considered in the prayer. So all of this, what we are talking about, the Imam, he said, just to recap, that if you do an action from the prayer, so if you do actions which are not from the prayer, it doesn't matter whether you did it intentionally or unintentionally. That doesn't have any effect. What has an effect is whether you did a lot of it. If you did a lot of it, then that breaks the prayer. And we discussed how you can determine what is a lot. Okay? If it's not a lot, then that doesn't break the prayer. The Imam, he says, الدرب الثاني, after talking about the ziyada, the increase in the actions. So we spoke about increase. We said the increase can be like you increase in a ruku, a rukan or a ruku. The increase can also mean that you leave out a pillar of the prayer. Right? By the time you've made it up, and you've done the sajdat sahw, and you've done the taslim, it adds up to being an increase. But that's a valid increase. Now he comes to the second category of the reasons why we would do prostrations. He says, an-naqs, deficiency, an-naqs. Kanisyan al-wajib, like for example, you forget an obligatory action in the prayer. And then he gives an example. He says, فَإِنْ قَامْ عَنْ تَشَهَدِ الْأَوَّلِ, if you stand up from doing the first tashahud, you were supposed to do the tashahud al-awwal, which is a wajib, but you forgot to do it, so you stood up. You went straight to the third rakah. What do you do? He says, فَذَكَرَ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَسْتَتِمَّ قَائِمًا. So the person, he remembered before he got up completely. Right? So the Imam says, رَجَعَ فَأَتَى بِهِ. He goes back to the tashahud al-awwal and he completes it. And there's no sujood upon him. Sheikh Abd Aziz al-Rajihi, in his explanation, as other ulama do, he breaks this down into three more detailed issues. He says, look, this person who is doing the tashahud al-awwal, which is a wajib, and he's forgotten it. So he's about to stand up, right? He remembers before he stands up. What should he do? He goes back straight away and does the first tashahud. But he doesn't have to make a sujood, right? Because he did it before he went to the next rukun, which is standing, okay, for the next rakah. If a person does it, he gets up for the next rakah, but he hasn't started reciting Surah Al-Fatiha, then here, it's makruh for the person to return. It's disliked. But if he does return to the tashahud al-awwal, He can do the tashahhud al-awwal, but then he has to make sujood sahwu at the end. The first one we said no sujood sahwu. This one, he stood up, but he didn't recite Surah Al-Fatiha yet. He remembers. He can go back to the tashahhud al-awwal, the first tashahhud, and he can make that tashahhud, but now he has to make sajdatu sahwu at the end of the prayer. And here it's makruh. Okay? The third situation, the person gets up from the tashahhud al-awwal. He's standing now. He's taking a deep breath. He started reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. Here, the person cannot go back and make up the wajib, because now that position for the wajib has been missed. It's haram for him to go back. Why? Because now he started another rukun. He's gone to a rukun. So what he has to do, as we will come to know, he has to make this wajib up by doing sajdatu sahwu, by prostrating for it. He cannot now make up the wajib. It's finished for him. He's past its position, right? وَإِن نَسِيَ The Imam, he says now, he speaks about a rukn. وَإِن نَسِيَ رُكْنًا If he forgets a pillar, not forgetting a wajib. We spoke about wajib. Wajib basically, if you remember in the position, or before you get to a rukn, right, then you can make that wajib up. If you don't remember the wajib, you just carry on. And you make up for it at the end of the prayer by prostrating, two prostrations. Now the Imam, he says, وَإِن نَسِيَ رُكْنًا If he forgets a pillar, فَذَكَّرَهُ قَبْلَ شَرُوءِهِ فِي قِرَاءَةِ رَقَةٍ أُخْرَى He forgets the pillar, like he forgot to make what? The ruku, for example, okay? Or he forgot to recite Surah Al-Fatiha. He can go back and he can catch that rukun because he remembered it, but before he gets into the next rukun, right? Before he gets into the next rukun. So again, the Imam, he says, وَإِن نَسِيَ رُكْنًا So if he forgets a rukun, فَذَكَّرَهُ قَبْلَ شُرُوئِهِ فِي قِرَاءَةِ رَقَةٍ أُخْرَى But he remembers his rukun before he gets to the next rak'ah, sorry, where he starts to recite Surah Al-Fatiha. Okay? So for example, he forgot the ruku, he forgot a sujood, or any of the arkan, and he remembers, he straight away must go back to complete that rukun as long as he hasn't reached the next rak'ah where he's going to recite Surah Al-Fatiha. So as long as he hasn't reached that Surah Al-Fatiha point and he remembers that he forgot a rukun, he must go back and complete that rukun. Tayyib? فَرَجَعَ فَأَتَى بِهِ وَبِمَا بَعْدَهُ So he goes back, completes the rukun, and carries on from there as though it never happened, as though mistake never happened. We clear so far, inshallah? وَإِن ذَكَرَهُ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ But if he remembers the rukun after that, meaning he remembers the rukun after he started reciting Surah Al-Fatiha, then he cannot go back. Then what happens? بَطَلَتْ أَرَكَ أَلَّتِي تَرَكَ مِنْهَا تَرَكَهُ مِنْهَا What happens now? You've read Surah Al-Fatiha. You remember that you forgot to recite Surah Al-Fatiha in the previous rak'ah. Or you forgot to make ruku in the previous rak'ah. Or you forgot to make sujood in the previous rak'ah. All of these are arkan. What do? You can't go back. So what you do now is because you've started a new rukun where Surah Al-Fatiha is, you consider the first one as obsolete. It's finished. And the one you're doing now, the second one, okay, will take the place of the first one. So you've got into the position of reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. So you consider the one before where you left a rukun as being obsolete. Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala and Shaykh Uthaymeen and others, they're of the opinion that you can always go back to complete a rukun so as long as you haven't come to the same rukun in the next rak'ah. So it gives you more time. Our Imam and those who agree with him, they're saying you can complete the rukun as long as you don't come to Surah Al-Fatiha in the next rak'ah. Imam Shafi'i and Uthaymeen and others, may Allah have mercy upon them, they're saying, no, you can complete as long as you don't come to the same position in the next rak'ah. You still have all that time. So for us, say for example, we forgot to make the sajda, and then I get up, right? And I remember once I start reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. For us, according to our Imam, we cannot go back now and complete that rukun. That ruku now completely, that whole rak'ah, that whole unit of prayer is thrown away. But according to the other opinion of Imam Shafi and others, they say, no, you just keep going, right? And if you remember any time before you get to the same rukun which was left in the next rak'ah, you have all that time to go back and make it up. As long as you don't get to the same position in the next rak'ah. Tayyib? So the Imam, he then says, وَإِن نَسِيَ He's giving another example now of leaving the arkan. He says, وَإِن نَسِيَ أَرْبَعَ سَجَدَاتٍ مِنْ أَرْبَعَ رَكَعَاتٍ He says, for example, 4 units of prayer. And in each unit of prayer, you left one sajda. In each unit of prayer, somehow, you're newly married, wonderful time you're having, very hard to concentrate on the salah. You're praying salah. In each unit of prayer, you've left one sajda. So the imam, he says, فَذَكَرَ فِي التَّشَهُدْ الْأَخِيرِ. So this person, he's in his last tashahud, and then he remembers, hang about, each of these rakah which I've prayed, I left one sajda. I've left a rukun in each rakah. What does he do? He says, سَجَدَ فِي الْحَالِ. He says, as soon as he remembered now, in the last tashahud al-akhir, he makes another sajda. Why? Because then that will now make for him one complete rakah. All three before will be thrown away. But now he's remembered in the tashahud al-akhir, he's got nowhere else to go. But he's remembered, hang about, I've got to make up all these sujoods. So he does one more, so that validates for him now one complete rakah. And then he gets up from that one rakah and he continues the prayer to make up the second, then tashahud, then the third, then the fourth, then tashahud, and then the prostrations, right? فَصَحَتْ لَهُ رَكَعَةٍ. So one of his rakahs will be complete. ثُمَّ يَأْتِ بِثَلَاثَ رَكَعَةٍ. And then he will come with the other three rakahat. The imam, he says, فَمَتَّ شَكَ فِي تَرْكِ رَكَعَةٍ أَوْ فِي تَرْكِ رُكْنٍ فَهُوَ كَتَرْكِهِ. Whenever the person has a doubt, have I left a rukn? He's having a doubt in the prayer. Did I leave a rukn? Right? Then he should consider it as though he did leave the rukn. He's having a real doubt. We all know what doubt is, right? 50-50 kind of thing. Right? He's not 70-30. He's 50-50. He's really doubtful. Did I leave the ruku? Did I leave the sujood? What he should do, he should say, yes, I left it. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in the hadith, sorry, so فَمَتَ شَكَ. So when he has a doubt of leaving the rukun, he considers it to be a doubt. طيب. But if the doubt is in a wajib, if the doubt is in a wajib, then he doesn't consider it at all. He overlooks that doubt. Why? Because, just take it as that principle. It's a bit detailed to explain, but take it as this principle. The ulama, they say that if he had a doubt in a rukun, okay, then he takes it that he did leave that rukun. Okay? But if he has a doubt that he left the wajib, then ignore the doubt. Ignore the doubt. Okay, simplistically. So the imam, he says here, وَإِنْ شَكَّ فِي عَدَدِ رَكَعَاتٍ بَنَى عَلِ الْيَقِينِ. If the person has doubt in the number of raka'at, for example, did I pray three, did I pray two, or did I do the whole four? He's not sure. What does he do? He builds upon certainty. What is certainty in this situation?
What he knows he has
prayed. Which is? The lesser number, right? So if I'm thinking, did I pray three or did I pray two? We say we go with the lesser number, because whenever you doubt in a rukun, You say that, yes, I left it, okay? So doubting in the actual number of rak'ah is even more. It's even more of a serious issue. And the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith in Sahih Muslim, إِذَا شَكَّ أَحَدُكُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِ فَلَمْ يَدْرِ كَمْ صَلَّ ثَلَاثًا أَمْ أَرْبَعًا فَلْيَطْرَحَ الشَّكَّ وَلْيَبْنِي عَلَى مَسْتَيْقَنَا ثُمَّ يَسْجُدْ سَجْدَتَيْنِ قَبْلَ أَنْ يُسَلِّمْ. The Prophet ﷺ said, if one of you has doubt in his prayer, and he doesn't know how much he prayed, the hadith in Sahih Muslim, did he pray three or did he pray four? Then he should leave alone the doubt and he should build upon certainty. Certainty is always the lesser. Build upon certainty, which is the lesser. And then he should make two prostrations at the end of the prayer before the taslim. Okay? So again, what do we do in a situation of doubting the rukun? We consider it that I didn't do it. In doubting a wajib, we ignore the doubt. Okay? Tayyib? Tayyib. Shaykh Uthaymeen in Sharh al-Mumta' volume 3, he said, if the person has doubt, once the worship, the act of worship is finished, once you finish the taslim, and after 10 minutes you start to doubt, ignore it, even if it's a rukun. After the worship we're talking about, right? You have doubt after the worship, ignore it completely, okay? This is doubt. This is not knowing for sure that, yes, I left a rukun. This is doubt, right? And then the imam, he says, illa imam khasa. Except for the imam. The imam doesn't do what we've just mentioned about leaving the rukun. Okay? Why? فَإِنَّهُ يَبْنِي عَلَىٰ غَالِبِ ظَنِّهِ. For verily the imam, what he should do, he should strive to the best of his ability to recall. غَالِبَ الظَّنِّ means to the best of one's ability to recollect. And then he should build upon his recollection. So if the imam thinks, yeah, I did actually pray three instead of two, he goes with the three. Why? Why do you think? Why? Why is it different from the imam? Ahsanta, Jazakallah khair. Very good. Because the people behind him will remind him, right? They will make tanbih for him. They will remind him. Whereas if you're on your own, you've got nobody to really tell you. So the Imam, he acts upon the best of his exertion in his mind. And if he's wrong, the people behind him will correct him. Very good. Jazakallah khair. The Imam, he says, this is the difficult part. If you thought the first part was difficult, this is the difficult part. But it's actually easy if we break it down and simplify it. And I have a glad tiding for you in the explanation anyway. So the Imam, he says, وَلِكُلِّ سَحْوٍ سَجْدَتَانْ قَبْلَ سَلَامٍ. For every forgetful action, everything you forgot, there's two prostrations before the taslim. Two prostrations you do before the taslim. So anything you forget and you've made it up, you've made up the wajib, you've made up the rukn, then the prostration should be before the taslim. إِلَّا مَنْ سَلَّمَ أَنْ نَقْسٍ فِي صَلَاتِهِ. Except for the one who makes the taslim, okay, and then he realizes that he had a shortcoming after the taslim. وَالْإِمَامِ إِذَا بَنَى عَلَىٰ غَالِبِ ظَنْهِ. And the Imam who exerted his effort to the best of his ability. وَالنَّاسِ لِلسُّجُودِ قَبْلَ السَّلَامِ. And also an exception from doing the sujood before the taslim is the one who wanted to do it before the taslim, but he forgot. So what he does then, he does it after the taslim. So these are exceptions again. So every person who forgets, they should do two prostrations of forgetfulness before the taslim, right? Except for the one who made the taslim, yet he had a shortcoming. Then he does it afterwards, after he completes his prayer. And also the imam who bases his actions upon the ghalab al-dhan. He exerts his effort in trying to remember, was it two or was it three? And also the one who forgot to do the sujood before the taslim, he does it afterwards. فَإِنَّهُ يَسْجُدُ سَجْدَتَيْنِ بَعْدَ سَلَامِهِ. For verily this person does the two sajdas after making the taslim. These categories of exceptions. So every other prostration is before salam. These extra categories are after the salam. So here, the person is going to get confused now. You're already confused in your prayer, trying to remember what is a rukn. You're trying to remember what is the wajib. What do I do now? Do I go back? Do I not go back? Do I have to make up the wajib? Or did the brother in his dar say, no, once you moved on from the wajib, you just forget it. So you're going to be confused, right? The ulama, may Allah have mercy upon them, they know our situation. And from time immemorial, they said, this is an important point. And this is collected by Ibn Hajj al-Asqalani, rahimahullah ta'ala, in his explanation of Sahih al-Bukhari, which is known as Fathul Bari, very famous explanation in volume 5, talking about the issue of the increase in the prayer. He said, the amat al-ulama, the majority of the ulama in the early stages of Islam, they agreed that this making the sujood al-sahw before the taslim or after the taslim, the debate about it is al afdaliyya, is about preference. Is it preferred to do because of this act after the salah, or is it preferred to do before the ending of the salah, before the taslim? So this confusion of whether to do it after or before, if you're unable to comprehend it, it's of no consequence whatsoever. It doesn't affect your salah, you don't lose any ajr whatsoever. So they give us this glad tiding, and in fact Imam Nawawi and others, Imam Mardawi and others, they said there's ijma on this issue, right? The difference of opinion came later on. The early scholars, it was like they had a consensus of agreement on this issue, that it doesn't really matter whether you did it after the taslim or before the taslim, okay? So this simplifies matters for us a bit. So the Imam, he also says that after you make the sajda to sahwu and you make the taslim, what you have to do, you have to make tashahud al-akhir again and you have to make the taslimatain again. This is the Imam's opinion and those who agree with him based on the hadith which is found in Abi Dawood and Tirmidhi. The hadith of Imran ibn Hussein, where the Prophet ﷺ did this. Of course, the ulama, they're debating over whether the hadith is authentic, and that's why you have the difference of opinion. Many ulama, they say you don't have to do this extra tashahud. So you've made sajdatain, right? Sajdat al-sahw. You've made the prostration of forgetfulness before you made the taslim. According to the most of us now, that's going to be the end of our prayer. Our imam is saying, no, after that you have to make the tashahud al-akhir again, and then you have to make the taslim again. And that's based upon this hadith, which is found in Abi Dawood and Tirmidhi, the hadith of Imran ibn Hussein, and the difference of opinion is based upon whether you see the hadith was authentic or not. So if you're following an imam who says the hadith is authentic, you do it. If you're following an imam who says the hadith is not authentic, you don't do it, as simple as that. The imam, he says, وَلَيْسَ عَلَى الْمَأْمُومِ سُجُودٌ إِلَّا أَنْ يَسْهُوَ إِمَامُهُ فَيَسْجُدْ مَأْمُمُ. The ma'mum, the one who is praying with the imam, he doesn't have to make sajda to sahu. He doesn't make prostration of forgetfulness. So the person is praying in the salah, he forgot to say Subhana Rabbi al-A'la in the sujood. It's okay. The imam carries his mistake for him. He doesn't have to make prostration of forgetfulness. That's one of the beautiful things about praying in jama'ah. These mistakes we make, the imam will carry it for us as well as getting the extra reward, right? So our imam is teaching us that if you pray with the imam and you made a mistake in your salah, there's no prostration upon you because the imam carries your prayer for you. You only make the prostration of forgetfulness if the imam makes the prostration of forgetfulness. And here is another can of worms, so to speak. طيب. Let's try to simplify it. If you're praying with your imam, and you've got the whole of the prayer with your imam, it's very simple. You only make the prostration of forgetfulness when your imam makes the prostration of forgetfulness. But now if you're masbuk, what's masbuk? He joined late. What did he miss? After one rakah. He missed a rakah, right? He joined after the ruku or more. Or he missed more than that. So if you join as a masbuk, right? And the imam has made a mistake in the salah. You join as a masbuk, you've missed a rak'ah or so with the imam, right? And you've caught the imam in the prayer and he makes a mistake in the salah. If the imam, he makes the sujood before the taslim, you should prostrate with him, right? But after you finished your prayer, you have to again do the prostration of forgetfulness. Why? Because you did it in the wrong place for you, because your salah was not yet complete. But you had to do it with the imam because you were following the imam. Tayyib. In the same situation, if the imam did the prostration of forgetfulness after the taslim, you should not follow the imam in the sujood sahwi. You should sit, let him finish, you get up and complete your prayer, and then you make the sujood sahwi. Don't ask me to repeat. Go back to the video. A second situation. You come as the masbuk, and you catch the imam in the prayer after missing a rak'ah or more. The imam made a mistake in the prayer, but he didn't make it in the part that you caught with the imam. So the imam is now going to prostrate for his mistake. Right? You should prostrate with the imam, but in this situation, you don't have to prostrate again after you've completed your prayer. Wadih? Tayyib. I think there was one more after that. And if the imam in this situation that I just said, he made the prostration after the taslim, okay? In that situation that I just described, you do not prostrate with the imam, nor do you make it up with the imam. Okay, and the last sentence to take, that the imam, he says, may Allah have mercy upon him, وَمَنْ سَهَى إِمَامُهُ أَوْ نَابَ أَمْرٌ فِي صَلَاتِهِ. That if the imam is praying and he has forgotten something in the prayer, or somebody wants to remind him of something that he's forgotten in the prayer, فَتَصْبِيحُ لِلْرِجَالِ, then the men, they should remind him by saying Subhanallah, and the women, وَتَصْفِيق لِلْنِسَى, and the women, they should clap, okay? But they shouldn't make a song and dance out of it. They should just make a loud clap to remind the imam if they are close by the imam. Because the Prophet ﷺ said in Bukhari, إِذَا نَابَكُمْ شَيْءٌ فِي صَلَاةٍ فَلْيُسَبِّحْ الرِّجَالِ وَلْيُسَفِّقْ النِّسَاءِ. Okay, if you want to tell the imam something in the prayer, then the men should make tasbih, and the women, they should make tasfiq, they should do the clap, okay? And that is if they are close to the imam, but not if they are far away, because then it's of no benefit. صلى الله على نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. I ask Allah عز وجل to give us understanding and ability to implement what we've learnt. Inshallah, confusions, please go back to the video and I'm sure you'll be able to understand by watching it 2 or 3 times. And I'd like to remind myself and the brothers to get the full benefit of coming. Try to bring a pen and paper. I know some of you, mashallah, Allah mubarak, like Imam Shafi, you have great memories, but maybe later on you'll forget. So try to bring pen and paper, take notes. Every note that you take, you're getting reward for it. And maybe it's something that you can use in the future to teach your family, to teach your children, to teach other members in the community. Anything which was correct was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All shortcomings and mistakes were from myself and shaitan. Feel free to confuse ourselves with questions and corrections if you want to. And we see how we go.